Bjergsen, you know, saving that pick for Bjergsen, going back to TSM's core, TSM's identity, the mid, is going to be what they should focus on.
And RNG has always looked better when they priority mid lane. I'm expecting something like a Syndra, like the Victor coming out for Xiaohu that he's comfortable on. Give him a comfortable matchup, because right now he's always getting played against.
He looked very, very bad in their game versus Samsung.
Horrible.
But then again, so did Bjergsen. So both of these guys are looking to rebound, and this is all about the mental preparation. You know, the strength that these teams have in between games is one of the things that TSM as an organization have focused heavily on. And you know, you hear a lot of stories about RNG and how these issues have plagued them.
Yeah, certainly have. And I mean, when you have a team that is pretty much coached by the support, when he's down, it becomes very hard to pull the team back together and be able to set up those clutch game winning plays.
And you mentioned the support, Mata. I think that is a huge deal. Will they go with an Alistar? The thing they beat TSM with last time around. Double have said that Mata was just crazy, and that's why they're coming at him. But we've already got our first big move here. Xiaohu back on the Aurelion Soul, so this should not be unexpected for TSM.
And the LPL teams, before we dive into it, love to play Aurelion Soul Hyper Carry. Because when you get the Rylai's Crystal Scepter, it is incredibly hard to engage on this carry. So I'm expecting some very big hard engage to come out of TSM, either in the top lane with something like a Kennen again, or through their jungle pick.
Options available. Elise is still up. Rek'Sai is still up with Lee Sin and Nidalee off the table. Maybe they go that direction. TSM have got 20 seconds to decide where they go. What else does Bjergsen have in the tank to play into this Aurelion Soul? We've seen a lot of Vladimir, seen a lot of Syndra when it's up and available.
Key for me is some hard CC versus Aurelion Soul. If you tag him with one thing, anything, Retract the Stars takes out all of the teamfight presence. We saw some of the shortcomings. If he doesn't roam, if he doesn't get ahead early, if you can lock him up with some sort of safer CCs, then he becomes a fairly juicy target, right?
Well, first time Jace for Team Solo Mid here at Worlds. Are we anticipating that in Bjergsen's hands? Keep Aurelion Soul at bay, or is that going up top to Haunter?
Probably a Haunter pick there, but that's the beauty of it, right? You can still flex it, and you can threaten to flex, but definitely would expect up towards the top side versus Looper.
So one more time, Uzi goes towards the Ezreal, and it's not a champion that he has really been known for in the past. I mean, sure, he's had some good games on it, but you know, you much more expect the hyper carries like the Caitlyn, although it's banned away, or even something like a Twitch to really set Uzi up for success.
Oh, here we go. The rise again into Aurelion Soul, this time for Bjergsen. Now, I love the new rise, and it is, a lot of people aren't able to keep up with all the updates. There are a lot of changes to Ryze, and this iteration, to me, is actually the most flexible version of Ryze, because you can opt to super high damage output, getting all the resets on your overload with your other abilities, or you can pop that shield and speed at any moment that you want, or go for the 2-second snare and set up early kills. That's why I'm going to be looking at the Bjergsen comboing Wisp and Skarn on the Rek'Sai. This is a very decent 2v2 matchup, especially if you get there first. As far as the mid lane duel does go. Probably had a problem there in Champion Select as it come back to us.
It is with Mata's keyboard. It will give you an update as soon as I hear anything further. Obviously, with that Aurelion Soul locked in, it means Haunter will be having his first showing on Jace in that top lane. On Ryze. And of course, now, what does this mean for Team Solo Mid looking forward? Because they've got a lot of carries, they've got a lot of flanking potential, but no real hard front line just yet, you know, with that Braum supports.
Yeah, so they have Braum support.
And Rek'Sai.
Exactly. Yeah. Unbreakable is really good, and Rek'Sai can go full tank. We have seen a lot of Tiamat versions of Rek'Sai for the fast clear, but the full tank version is very much still viable. Clearlift does it a lot as well, and Svenskeren can definitely go that route. With both Unbreakable and a Rek'Sai full tank on the front line, that's a very strong team fight. I do expect them to go that way, that they've locked in Lucian, because Doublelift loves to play, very quick and fast inside the team fights. He's very good at keeping 100% DPS uptime on even a short range AD carry, only 500 range now on Lucian. Remember how dangerous it is to play this champion.
That's the biggest thing for me. I mean, Haunter, Bjergsen, and Doublelift have to pick their windows of damage when the limited CC is out, when the Braum ultimate as well as the Rek'Sai and Burrow go in. Look for them to dive into that team fight. Look to pick up the scrappy kills.
Dodging the Elise Cocoon and the Nami bubbles becomes much more difficult when you're facing an Aurelion Soul. If, as you say, he gets to that Rylai's Crystal Scepter, the slow and the zone control that he does have with the giant star can create a lot of problems as far as navigating through the team fights and creating that space for Lucian to get his work done.
So much pressure on Doublelift to step up. He's had one questionable game, one very good game throughout the course of the day. It's very obvious where the crowd is cheering. You guys jump on a Twitter and let us know if you think it is TSM win or if RNG will cause the upset. Winner take all advances to the quarterfinals. And this early game is going to be tense. Whether or not MLXG can pull off some magic and disrupt these laners of Team Solo Mids.
All of North America's hopes for TSM ride on this game. This is a team that has put everything into this particular year. This iteration of the team has had the most support, the most practice, the most dedicated players that we have ever seen from the region.
And on the other side, just to juxtapose, RNG was a team that went to MSI. They went deep in the group stages and unfortunately fell down 3-1 against SKT. They made the change and brought Uzi in, who is one of the most touted AD carries from China of all time. If they fail here in a group stage, massive loss for this team.
Two legends facing off in the bot lane right now. Doublelift and Uzi.
Simultaneously, two fantastic junglers facing off. That's the priority of Riot Games 2. Tune into that if you want to. A little bit of trades very early on. And I'm a little nervous for TSM because Uzi has a bit of a penchant for showing up in at least one of three games.
Everybody playing in this game, everybody watching this game, everyone associated with League of Legends right now is definitely nervous, Quickshot.
They certainly are in the Uzi games. You know, one in every three, it is said that he will just explode and carry a game 1v9. He needs to do so now.
Doublelift himself talked about how much he looked up to Uzi. This guy, when he was on the world stage, making it to the finals, his play, especially on things like Caitlyn, mechanical outplays and the team fighting from him were so crisp. He's very, very good at his animation canceling and very good as far as dodging skill shots.
Now, I'm going to anticipate a slightly slower early game with all that is at stake in this game. Teams can play a little slower and a little risk averse, but obviously down this bottom lane, Nami's gonna have a good advantageous lane into the melee support of Braum.
Oh, Mata's actually doing a very good job kiting there. You can see barely with the outrange. I mentioned Lucian's 500 range there for the auto attacks. It's just outside. There's no exchange there. It's purely one-sided, and every auto does count.
Oh,
just like every star counts.
That was five in a row for Xiaohu. Much more comfortable on the champion than we just saw from Senkux. And Bjergsen's going to have a tough time this lane. Refillable potion is going to help him out.
Let's immediately start talking about the junglers as they have almost both gotten to level three. They're on their third camps now. Immediately you see Xiaohu shove up the lane on the Aurelion Soul and go for vision, trying to get some, you know, some extra information as to where Svenskeren is.
However,
very good defensive ward there.
That is a defensive ward. That's what I wanted to point out. It isn't the aggressive ward into the blue buff pit. It is just nice and shallow, making sure that he can spot out jungle pathing. And now they're finally pinging in.
I actually would encourage Svenskeren to go for the attempt on Scuttlecrab rather than the blue, but he starts up the blue anyway to try and hand over to Bjergsen. And this ward that was placed by Xiaohu, remember, that will see Bjergsen walking over there. They know he's trying to hand it off, and they've got a bush. Woo, not in that bush. he's at the base, okay.
Xiaohu's already
the tension
away.
Is overflowing at
it
the moment.
It really is, because there's so much on the line. Svenskeren's forced away from his blue buff. Mata's come up to support MLXG.
Cocoon
lands, Aqua Prison just sidestep. All of a sudden, MLXG repels up, jumps to the Sentinel. Xiaohu's coming in from the river.
Whoa.
It's going to be pressure now on TSM.
That is so incredibly impressive that RNG were able to pull off that invade without a mid laner. Their bottom lane pushed up so far, and Mata on this abusive Nami for the laning phase. they're able to go steal away this blue that was supposed to be handed off to Bjergsen and run Svenskeren off of that Grump. Very big power play from RNG, even without Xiaohu having mid lane presence.
And now let's talk about what that does for mid lane, because Xiaohu is going to be able to continually push up, and the Ryze cannot match due to the mana constraints.
And it's not just mid lane, it's the entire map. Whenever Aurelion Sol gets an extra back like that, he's got the purchase now advantage over Bjergsen. There was an extra buy here, now he's got the ring, and that vision you talked about in the mid lane, top and bottom, RNG's advantage. You can see it's affecting Bjergsen in the way that he's playing the lane now.
Yeah, Bjergsen does marginally have a CS advantage. Flash Cleanse or his Summoner spells, Uzi and Marta, they're going to have some advantage as this lane pushes towards them. Biofrost blocking a lot of damage with that shield, catches a bubble as well. Arcane Shift sends Uzi to safety, but Double Lift still under a lot of pressure.
It was actually a very good exchange there for TSM, because they're trading with Cannon Minion and with some ranged minions on their side, and they got a decent amount of damage. But here comes the Roam as well as the
No Exhaust
from Elite.
Here out of Biofrost.
They smell it coming.
Good play from Team Solo Mid. Luckily, have most likely scrimmed against Huhi and CLG. They smell it and back out.
Cross-map play is actually coming in. You can see Looper also has to back away from his turret, so they're very aware of this play right now, RNG.
And you can see it in Double FCS. This is an abusive matchup here. The Ezreal Nami once again used for laning prowess. When combined with a mid laner that has so much global presence like Aurelion Sol, and the respect you have to give to that pick when the pings go down, the missing pings, it is insane. And Double If now is going to have to try and carry the game from a CS deficit.
Oh, decent little interrupt by Looper, still takes the damage though. And as it stands, Haunter is ahead. Look at the CS, plus, what's that, 18 or so, it's a lot. In the mid lane, plus 5 for Bjergsen and Svenskeren, currently out farming MLXG. That is why they've got a marginal lead, but it is all at the expense of Double If and Biofrost lane.
Definitely true. The other thing about being pinned under your turret like this, especially with, you know, these being normal lanes, you know, there's no lane swaps, there's no way of getting out of it. Even though the teleport was just used there, there's no opportunity at all for TSM, for Biofrost and Double F to get a deep ward. You won't be able to see junglers walking up through the lane wards. They're pinned under their turret, so they have absolutely no vision. And it's the fact that that's combined with the loss of presence around mid lane, due to Xiaohu on the Aurelion Sol and that matchup. That being said, Bjergsen is farming well and is getting his last hits.
Yeah, and this is the important thing. You have to weather the bottom lane whilst accumulating advantages on the top side of the map. That's all TSM's game plan is right now, because you pick Nami to win lane, you pick Braum to win the team fight.
The thing is, you pick Poppy to just build full tank and be on the front line and be serviceable with a CS deficit. Lucian, a bit more difficult to do the same. Cole has picked up here for Double Lift once again, but this time around he's not ahead, he's far behind, and it's more of a reactive, gonna try and cash in later. I don't expect them to take
look
any
at the
fights.
River. Look at the river, look at the river! The bubble catches Biofrost!
Will they go
here
over?
Comes a comment of legend, Biofrost puts up the Unbreakable, sidesteps the stun, Voice of Light doesn't kill him, because Uzi does! First blood secured for Royal, never give up! Svenskeren follows, Lordly not gonna go down yet! That's a double kill for Uzi! Double lifts in trouble, triple kill for Uzi!
And we already talked about it, the Uzi game, he's up in CS, now he has an early triple kill, and this is exactly what Royal wanted.
The pressure around bottom lane overflows. Mid lane and jungle come crashing down again, and that is a sweeping victory for Royal Never Give Up.
And this is just raw aggression. Svenskeren wants to match the ward challenge. However, RNG want to be able to catch them out, and Double Lift tries to save Biofrost.
You got a flash for that super early. I mean, very risky going up into the river. They have no control mid or control down bottom. And RNG, this is the area of the map you want to fight around. You mentioned the discrepancy between top and between bottom. This is RNG's side. They play off their power. They get a huge lead. First blood, 3 kills, first turret as well. And man, this is going to be a difficult comeback for TSM.
It was a phage and a sheen inside Uzi's itemization. He sold the phage, opted into the pickaxe for now. So much money, he doesn't even know what he wants to buy.
Yeah, 100%. But what you can trust out of Uzi is the fact that he likes damage efficiency. I was surprised to see the phage, because what he wants is get towards that Mora mana, stack it up as quickly as possible, and if you get it around the 19-minute mark with the Trinity Force, this guy's going to be a monster.
Now remember, Team Solo Mid opted into this pick and ban phase. They allowed the Aurelion Sol through, and Xiaohu's been able to put a lot of pressure with the help of MLXG down in the bottom lane. There's an Infernal Drake up and no tower. So if TSM have to concede control of that portion of the map, RNG could grab another objective uncontested.
Exactly, and remember, this is still RNG's side of the map. This is their blue buff. They've got all the vision inside the blue quadrant. You want to continue to play off your side of the map that you have pressure on, and they're doing just that, continuing to bully Double Lift under the turret.
But the great adaptation here is they've warded out a jungle camp. There's a pink ward top side of the map, so even if TSM want to cross map them right now, it should mean that Looper gets out scot-free just by backing away from the turret. So a much more controlled RNG, like the first game we saw against TSM, going back to that slow start.
And this is great for RNG, sucks for TSM. Infernal Drake is going to be the first Drake taken here. RNG continue to snowball. That's going to get all of their damage purchases an extra percentage boost.
Yeah, especially if this game continues to play out. It's a 2,000 gold deficit. Hornsa is doing very well in this top lane. He's plus 35 CS, keeping Looper down, but poke is not really what's going to help you if Aurelion Sol and Elise decide to jump on you. A little bit of pressure in the top lane, as you can see. Xiaohu making his way up. And down bottom, TSM just trying to fend off Uzi and Mata.
One tiny thing I want to talk about in regards to the Infernal is GLP plus defensive item, not really all that much AP. It's not going to help out Xiaohu. At the same time, Trinity Force user generally into a Blade of the Ruined King, not really going to help out Uzi as well. There are some comps that benefit a lot more from an Infernal Dragon. It's still great, don't get me wrong, but this is not one of those comps that it's just very overbearing to play against.
Well, playing against Aurelion Sol is quite overbearing.
Certainly is.
That's what TSM are trying to deal with. RNG with a great advantage in the early game. Got themselves a lead. Looper's used his teleport, so Haunter will have that advantage if opportunities break out elsewhere on the map. And Team Solomid may need to use some map plays to claw back this deficit.
And that's the thing. Opportunities don't just present themselves to you. You have to create your own advantages in League of Legends. And there's no wards down bottom, no deep wards for a deep teleport. Plus, Looper is more than serviceable on this Poppy, even with the CS deficit, taking a huge chunk out of Haunter's health bar. Here comes the rest of RNG.
Yeah, three members head towards the top lane. They're trying to force them off the turret.
Sven-Skeren catches Sven-Skeren. Voice of Light not going to kill just yet. Xiaohu's looking for more. Gets it with the expansion. Kill number four, and TSM's hopes are dwindling away. Haunts is electing to teleport up. Gonna have the support of Bjergsen as well as Biofrost shortly. Double Lift is not there. This is currently a 3-on-3. Looper looks for the stun. Cleanse used by Bjergsen. The tidal wave thrown out. Couple of summoners exchanged, but Team Solo Mid hold on to their top tower for now.
Two summoner spells. Burn on Bjergsen for only one of Looper, as well as the teleport, matching that global pressure, means that now RNG, they're just going to be happy with isolating these lanes, trying to continue to rotate the Aurelion Sol around the map, because as long as Bjergsen can't follow because of the push, they're at a disadvantage.
The American dream, the number one Western hope. All of the pressure on Team Solo Mid, and they have to claw it back. The expectations on this team coming into Worlds was the greatest, arguably, of any Western team to date. There's been some debate about whether or not Fnatic last year had higher expectations, but for Team Solo Mid, with support staff, with how dominant they were in summer, with the talent they've drafted, this is a tough situation to be in.
They're definitely going to have to dig deep to pull this one back. First step, though, in taking back vision control of their blue quadrant has been taken by Biofrost. Cleared out a few of the wards and placed some defensive vision of TSM's own. RNG quickly go to remedy the situation, though.
And this is where it gets tense, because you can see playing bottom side versus playing top side, they want to be able to pressure Looper. That is where the gold disparity is right now. But making plays onto the full tank Poppy all tournament long has been so difficult to execute upon.
TSM setting up a counter here, but they have to be so, so wary.
Haunter's in trouble. He's got a flash available. Gonna need to use it shortly. Can't when he's in the Steadfast Presence. Knocked up into the air. Celestial Expansion doesn't get a kill.
Shout
can flash over. Voice of Light gets the damage down. Looper uses the Buckler. Manages to stay alive. Slowed down by Biofrost. Ignite is out. That's Team Solo Mid's first kill. Sven-Skeren's running for his life. A level 7 double lift is being tagged by the stars. And Xiaohu wants to send them packing. A Akalik is interrupted. surrounded by the Cocoon. Knock up on MLXG. Second kill for TSM, but it's a 2-for-2 in favor of Royal Never Give Up. Xiao, who's going to continue to back away, and Marta and Uzi are low. A lot of damage on that Alta turret.
Finally, they back away. RNG playing on the knife's edge there, and great response, especially out of Biocross, taking the bullet, stepping in front of this tidal wave.
All right, let's look at Looper catching Haunter on the wall. Going to get the flash out of him as well, but man, that was so close for the Cocoon landing as well. Here comes the ult from Xiaohu over the wall, and everybody goes for the dive. Biofrost does have the kill secured, and Svenskeren also forced to flash away.
But this is where it gets really dicey, because it looks like Double Lift is zoned. It looks like this is going to be a three-man wave, and Biofrost tanks it up for his team. Huge ulti, and MLXG went too deep.
Yeah, exactly. The rest of the team, the DPS behind MLXG trying to get there, slowed down by Biofrost ultimate and not quite able to answer in time. It almost looked like Bjergsen and Double Lift wanted to create something else after that play too, but disengaged from RNG and they hold on to their lead.
Thanks to all the action in the top lane, Team SolarMid able to secure their blue buff. Bjergsen grabbed that one. Xiaohu grabbed his own. GLP picked up along with those Merc treads. Items starting to be completed for TSM. Black Cleaver for Hornsa, but Bjergsen still waiting for his first big pickup. Rune Prison comes down, throwing out those overloads as many as he can, and Xiaohu opts not to use his W.
And now there is a small window where Teleport is available for Looper, but not available for Haunter, so they're playing opposite sides of the map right now. If TSM want to defend their top lane turret, they're going to have to give away the Mountain Drake.
Yeah, 5 seconds until that one spawns. And if there were dragons to fight over, Fire and Mountain would be exactly those. Team SolarMid have lost control of their vision. They had decent wards earlier, and it looks like RNG are going to start this one. Appears to be no contest. There's a great circle of pinks and invisible wards deep for RNG to play with.
RNG, they do the first step. They lay down all the vision through the blue buff side of TSM so that there's no possibility of TSM coming to contest. They take their relatively free Drake.
But not only that, they just leave the jungler to do it by itself and get all of that chip damage done on the turret, because normally, if you're giving up a Drake, it's a time that you can get a free shop in. But RNG still punished for the maximum.
They are indeed. Horns is down in the bottom lane with Teleport, making his way to Looper, who's in the bottom lane, with Teleport available. Didn't take advantage of having that additional global just yet. And for Royal Never Give Up, they've had a questionable group stage so far today. Really looking out of sorts, and this could justify
that. Oh,
here we go. Comet of Legends coming up, Haunts is the target, no flak available. He should be able to sidestep the tidal wave, but it's such a great zoning tool. A lot of damage onto MLXG, but not enough to kill him. The rest of TSM, can they make a cross-map play?
Nope.
Top and middle are being pushed.
Yeah, I mean, they can keep Double Lift up there to try and trade a turret, but it's not going to be an advantage because RNG can pressure bottom side. They're converting
it. They're actually going to teleport for it.
Wow, they're teleporting on it, and Double Lift should definitely respect that. Okay.
That's actually, I think, a very questionable play there. Maybe RNG, you know, we've questioned their macro before, but not trying to trade objectives, especially when it's an outer, can come back to haunt you when you give up an important flanking tool like the teleport against this composition.
And that is TSM's way back into this game. If they get an extra hero advantage, if they can grab a fight in a 4v5 scenario or a 3v2 scenario, they need the wards to do that though, and it's been such a hard fight to get the vision in place, as RNG have shown a renewed focus.
Are we channeling Kamehameha on that move? I didn't see if Xiaohu started it.
So I actually want to talk about Xiaohu's build, because he's going towards the Rylai's as his second item. Doesn't feel like he needs the MR because he's so far ahead, and it is only really Bjergsen that is going to be doing any magic damage. So I really like this. It keeps Uzi safer, and Uzi is so accelerated that he has to become the target that you're taking out at the start of these team fights.
18-minute Trinity Force and Man Immune. There's 9 stacks on Xiaohu's Dark Seal. Tankiness being built for MLXG as well as Looper. Just continuing to grow further and further. And for Team SolarMid, it is still a 2,000 gold game. Actually, it's a 1,000. No, it is 2. My math is terrible. Too much pressure to count. They've held it even at 8 minutes. But again, it's because RNG got so many advantages so early, the risk increases for pushing deeper.
And it is the item spike that Spawn talked about for Uzi. He's got the double item completion here for Ezreal, and that just provides so much threat in the team fights when you consider all of the zoning of a full tank Poppy on the front line and Aurelion Sol circulating stars.
Bjergsen uses his ultimate just to get into tower. I do not believe RNG saw that, so they may not be the wise. It's a minute and a half cooldown. Ballpark at this stage. Needlessly Large Rod picked up as well, so there's additional damage coming out for Bjergsen.
This is a really dangerous turret to defend because it's two hits away from falling down, and RNG is one of those teams that will collapse on you after the team fight. No teleport available, but TSM, they just give it away. They take the trade.
Definitely encourage equal objective trades when behind like this.
His Haunts are going to get dove.
He's definitely getting roamed on.
Feels like that could be episode number 3 in the Haunts versus RNG saga. Going to be the number, the option just yet. Comet of Legend forward.
Yeah, Xiaohu
looking for Sven Skeren. GLP is marginally going to slow him down as he tunnels away to safety. But red buff was secured by TSM there.
And that's a big stacking wave top lane. So now all of a sudden they can rotate Xiaohu up there, keep their 1-3-1 in effect.
And double if they set double up to try and quickly push this lane. TSM, yes, it is a risky game. They're trying to keep control of the minions so that they don't build up and allow RNG to make one of those power dives on the other side of the map. Bottom, they do have a little bit of pressure, but here comes Looper.
2 minutes until the next Mountain Drake. Team Solo mid somewhat scattered in the mid lane. Bjergsen almost going to have access to that Realm Warp. And it looks like Double Lift made it out safely from the bottom lane. Keep your eyes on those CS numbers. Still positives for Bjergsen and Haunter. That's keeping them very relevant.
TSM have gotten to the farm for late mentality. They're trying to just continue to farm, and it's a risky game. RNG get a little more damage here on the mid turret as they take their toll for all of these extra moments that TSM are buying here.
And this is what it's about, rotating around the map, getting the chip damage, making sure you're constantly pressuring, because sure, the advantages are there. The big one is Ryze, but I would say that right now, the Jace's is not big enough because Poppy, 2 kills, starting to come online. One of the only pure tanks in this game. You can see gold deficit definitely isn't there.
Only the AD carry is truly the one that's feeling it. 1,300 gold, a BF sword separates Double Lift and Uzi thanks to that very, very early triple kill. There's 1 minute until the next Mountain Drake. Vision is pretty poor for both sides in that area of the map, but the wave is pushing towards Team Solo Mid, so that opens it up for Royal to get in there. And Spawn, for RNG, they've really got to help validate the LPL, because EDG, the heroes of China, they were so shaky and on the verge of being knocked out yesterday, much like RNG today.
Yeah, cannot echo that sentiment enough, but at the end of the day, this is the game that truly matters. Looper in trouble.
He is indeed. Steadfast Presence comes up. Very good three-man's keeper. And the verdict is Looper lives.
So he avoids a gank. Heart stop there for a second.
But important, flashes down, ultimates down. If a dragon is on the cards for Team Solo Mid, crucial abilities not available to Looper.
We will see. TSM need to pick their next battle very, very carefully. They're going to need to start the fight out with some extra damage on a target, whether it's, you know, Ryze snaring someone up at range for Hanzo to land his shockwave or shock blast, or it's somebody getting caught out while fighting for vision. The straight up head-to-head is still very difficult for them to maneuver just because of the extra zone control that, you know, RNG are bringing, in addition to how fed Uzi currently is.
And I still don't think you fight for it. I mean, right now you've got the Ryze scaling up, you've got Lucian scaling up. Double Lift has shown his proficiency on the champion late game. Just use it to get control back over the side of the map you want to play towards.
Very opportunistic look that you need to take at this from TSM side. And RNG, they're feeling very confident still. They take their extra objective, 3 dragons stacking up.
And
as
the
it
next
slowly
another
builds.
Mountain.
Honestly, though, I need to look top lane. I think RNG should force on this last standing outer turret. Those things are very flimsy. They have the extra power. They can just bully and brute force the extra objective down. That would mean that the entire outer perimeter for TSM has collapsed, but they still have not quite, you know, removed their... Ooh,
Looking for the play here, he's in trouble.
Gets the slow, Haunts is knocked back into the expansion. The star, the star backwards, but Uzi snipes him. That's his fourth kill of the game. Svenskeren is looking for more. Here comes Bjergsen with the Realm Warp. Not bringing in too much support though. Doublelift might be able to help. Xiaohu's still running for his life. It could be a 4-on-3. The Cocoon catches Doublelift. Biofrost joins. Glacial Fissure might get needed. The wall comes up. The Unbreakable Shield doesn't help Doublelift. He's in trouble. Flashes away with his life. Knocked up by the Keeper's Verdict. Doublelift still trying to run. Taken down by the... The damage onto MLXG. Looper gets Bjergsen, but the cleanse is already tagged. Eat the chair, Looper. He's Rune Prison in place under the tower, looking to kill Biofrost, but Bjergsen does it. It's a 3-for-3.
Ooh, very close, even exchange right there as TSM do answer the pick, and Hotzer also has teleport, but man, such an incredibly close team fight. Look at the aggressive move here. All right, they go 2 versus 1. TSM are the ones who actually started that out. And Haunter gets sniped. What a beautiful snipe from Uzi. That was very important, as you know, Jace can still add damage if not finished off, you know, from range. But there it is though. Bjergsen comes in with the ultimate.
So many summoner spells used prematurely here. Another flash, 1 into 3. The exhaust and flash already used from Marta, and TSM kited back beautifully.
That was a bit uncoordinated there from MLXG, but they knew they had Looper on the way, and you can see him dive so heavily into the turret.
As we jump out of the replay, Svenskeren dodges a potential Aqua Prison. The gold gain is now 1,000. After all of the positives for RNG, it equates to a 3 dragon lead rather than item and gold lead right now.
Key from the last fight is TSM got the shutdown on Uzi. That's a large amount of gold for them. Bjergsen flanked to the side, got the extra overloads onto Uzi, which are going to be difficult as we look at the team fights in the future. So RNG, they actually need to do a better job of screening for him, or Uzi himself needs to keep that line a bit clear. The thing is, it's kind of difficult because Ezreal himself also wants to have a clear line at the DPS target.
And there is so much power around this map right now. Bjergsen is huge.
He is indeed. Team Solo Mid got a 3-on-1 for now. MLXG's coming in from the side. No teleport for Looper, but there's a flank coming
from the jungle.
Tidal Wave is available for Marta. Aqua Prison is dodged, only catches the minions. Look for the Cocoon, doesn't tag. Svenskeren's behind, and he makes it out alive.
But one more time, they don't get the top lane turret. They force them down with double Mountain Drake. Do they go for Baron, or are they just looking for the turret?
TSM have a little bit of lingering vision around Baron. There we go, RNG do clear it out, and that is gonna be a bait. TSM have to be so much more careful than they have been in the past. They have no blue trinket available. Very risky situation.
Teleport is up for Haunter. And if he can get into position, the poke from those accelerated shock blasts can help onto RNG in the pit. Tidal Wave is used this time around. The target's Bjergsen. He's able to sidestep. Looks like he can get away. Xiaohu finds no target. And once again, Bjergsen survives with his life. Bjergsen's used Realm Warp. It is not available.
He actually got out of danger before using the Ryze ultimate there. We'll see if that actually does cost them. Haunter's trying to pressure on the bottom side. That's why RNG are forcing it.
The Baron's going so low. Double Mountain plus Infernal. Haunter's not started the teleport. Baron will go to Royal Never Give Up. There's no way of a steal. RNG get it.
They're over.
Sven's pinned against the wall. He will go down. A Baron and a death for a tower. It's not over yet. Doublelift uses the Ghostblade Culling. Voice of Light gonna tag him up. Tidal Wave's not available. GLP slows Doublelift. This might be it. Royal Never Give Up have Baron and a 5-on-3. Haunter continues to put pressure down bottom.
Xiaohu is coming up massive this game. Another flash forward. Crucial stun this time onto Doublelift, and they want to push it straight up mid lane.
Haunter did get 2 turrets for their troubles, but a huge cost there for TSM as RNG now with,
Doesn't look like he can. Saves the teleport. Who gives the kill? It should be Xiaohu. It's just a matter of consequence. 4-0-9. Baron and 3,000 gold down.
And RNG should not stop there. With the Baron buff, the last outer on top is easy pickings, and they can try and get some extra gold in their pockets for that victory.
Xiaohu right now, 10 stacks on his Darksteel, been there for so long. Bloodthirster picked up for Uzi. The power spikes really are coming out of this team. Matched reasonably well by TSM. However, it's just the fact that they've been picked off before these fights really have begun. Haven't seen a 5v5 since that one in the bottom lane.
The hope for TSM now is the Ryze. Bjergsen up so much CS with the 4 kills. All of the money, all of the hopes of TSM and North America channeled into the star mid laner.
But he's in the bottom lane. I mean, right now he's playing the opposite side of the map, so you're saying all this gold is there? They just have to give up top side priority.
That's exactly what Team Solomid are doing. Don't know if they would have been able to win a fight there anyway. A number of pink wards being used by RNG as they put pressure on the inner turret top. Teleport still available for Haunter. No real vision to work with. One small ward right on top of Marta. Culling interrupted by the cocoon and the tower's under pressure. Celestial Expansion and Star Surge alone allow RNG to get the tower. Look at the damage on Sven Skeren. 50% down without any pressure. Decent shock blast from Haunter. He needs about 17 more of those. Looking to get some poke down and RNG. 1 minute left on Baron. They're starting to siege the inhibitor turrets.
And this is what you want to see out of RNG. They're not a finesse side. Groupers five, brute force. Here we go.
There we go. Keeper's verdict is thrown out. I think Bjergsen was able to sidestep it. Round warp could be used. RNG, they're knocking down the inhibitors. 30 minutes go down. Good damage onto Xiaohu from the overload. Team Solomid are making RNG hesitate. Not anymore. Uzi breaks open the base. Super minions now pouring through. At some point, TSM have to decide to go in. Culling's going to come up shortly. They get some damage onto Looper, and the shock blast doesn't do a lot. RNG with a clean hit and run.
So difficult to get around the Aurelion Soul and the Poppy on the front line. Just bullying them off of the turret. TSM have to respect both of those owning abilities, and RNG claim the first inhibitor.
And this is why the LPL use Aurelion Soul to protect their carries, because it is so hard to get in on the champion. You can see time and time again, Bjergsen is on the same side as the Aurelion Soul and can't run through to get access to Uzi.
13 minutes into the game, Dragon number three, four rather, for RNG. It'll be the third Mountain Drake and the last Elemental Drake.
Oh, they're trying to steal here.
Sam trying to get it. Sven Skeren is in trouble. The pin gonna get sidestepped away, flashes into a tidal wave, ends up gifting that Drake to RNG.
Hand caught in the cookie jar there. TSM trying to steal it away as quickly as they could, but one of the little plays that they could go for. Honestly, it's so, so risky for them now. They have to turtle.
And there is no initiation. I mean, the only thing they can look for is a counter initiate out of Braum, because without Flash, Sven Skeren has no way to get past a Poppy onto the carry.
Honestly, so much credit to RNG. They had the much better game plan coming into this. So much pressure mid and bottom. Again, they focus their in-game play around it as well, constantly going there. MLXG from the very beginning, they push up with Mata. They take control of the jungle. They force all of their plays off that bottom quadrant.
Sven Skeren still waiting in the bush. Haunter got teleports available. Sven playing with his life. Biofrost plays a little bit of baseball and catches that True Shot Barrage, but the rest of RNG setting up on the side lane. Xiaohu, no flash available, but no real threat onto him. The Culling used to try and wave clear, but Double Lift is going to force to dash himself to safety. Tower number seven falls in favor of RNG.
And one more time, the Brute Force is still there. No Baron buff, but they still want it.
Yeah.
Poppy ulted its own.
Yeah, very, very effective. Team Solomid concede yet another turret. At what point do TSM say go? Maybe it's now. Biofrost is in trouble. He gets down the fissure. Bjergsen and Haunter on the side lane. They're interrupted. The hammer comes down. They've got a killer to Marta. Xiaohu's down. Xiaohu's down. Royal, they're running. They're dead. They're taken out. And Team Solomid, they turn onto Looper. Team Solomid, Ace, Royal, never give up.
They pull the trigger and TSM fight back.
Bjergsen comes up huge in that team fight, able to get on the back line for the first time, and he torches Uzi.
Look at this, it's RNG pulling the trigger before the inhibitor is down. Sven Skeren flanks around right into the middle. Then you see all the DPS, Haunter and Double Lift, go melee range in there to destroy RNG. They still did lose two members, but they barely defended their second inhibitor. That second inhibitor falling means so much for RNG, and TSM still have life in them yet.
They absolutely do. This buys enough time. This should get their top inhibitor to respawn. Baron is up in 45 seconds, and Team Solo Mid have around a minute on that inhib left. They are still very far behind and cannot afford any any mistakes.
They have bought themselves more time to look for an opportunity to punish a mistake from RNG. And around Baron, those have come from this team. If TSM are patient and they try and get the vision, there is a chance, but RNG still in control. They've got four Drakes. Baron up in 15 seconds. Let the dance begin.
Comets of Legend, Xiaohu's looking for Bjergsen. GLP comes out in the jungle. MLXG's a little bit of the target. Bubble onto Biofrost. Glacial Fissure may get needed. Sven still running for his life. Sven may go down. Eats the chair. Sven will die. Keeper's Verdict knocks him out along with the rest of
TSM. Double dead!
Double if he's dead. Bjergsen and Hornsa running for their lives. Biofrost is trying to catch as many as he can. Uses Stand Behind Me to jump to Bjergsen. It's a one for two. Bio's still in trouble. Running away. Mystic shot after Mystic shot. Gonna fall short. RNG win another team fight.
That should be the Baron for them, unless there's some miraculous play from TSM. And RNG with the Baron buff will come marching for that second inhibitor.
Bjergsen is still alive. This 5-0-5.
Shock blast. There's a ward inside for TSM. They know this. They already know that they're trying to bait. TSM have a ward inside Baron Pit.
So TSM by process of elimination. No.
And now Sven Skarren has ultimate, is going to be able to get... Oh, there's no tunnels, actually. They're going to start it up.
They are indeed starting it up. Royal never give up on the objective. Hornsa, you need to hit those shock blasts. Sends it flying. 2,000 HP. Biofrost looks for the steal, but it's Royal that secure it. Bjergsen and Hornsa looking for something on the way out. Teleport not available for Looper, but a gigantic minion wave down bottom. And just after, faith and hope is given to TSM. Royal never give up. Squash it. They have control.
TSM should grab that Scuttle Crab. What you want to do is delay the Scuttle Crab take as long as possible so that the extra vision lasts long, but you want to be able to get it before RNG obviously arrive.
And it is huge out of Looper. I mean, watch Looper here. Flashes, stops the tunnel, and gets the pin.
Beautiful there, interrupt from Looper. They also get the extra kill off it. And even though he sacrificed his life, that sacrifice so worth it as it opens up the Baron and the game.
And Looper isn't a flashy top laner, but he does the team thing. He's down 70 CS, but time and time again with this full tank Poppy is able to get the crucial stun.
Exactly. That's the role you take when you take the Poppy into Jace matchup. Yes, he's down a whole bunch of CS, but he just builds full tank. You go as the playmaker, and you shine later.
The damage onto Sven once again. Uzi, Mercurial Scimitar added to the collection.
And he's pretty much six items. I mean, he's going to upgrade the Last Whisper, but right now, two full items nearly above double it.
This is it. Last stand of TSM. Poppy ultimate here for the zoning, and they push him off the turret again.
It is fine. Nobody's knocked away, but it's not needed. It's just a zoning verdict. The tower falls. Round warp in from behind. Nobody takes the ride except for Sven Skarren, but he might be left out to dry. Forced to flash instantly. Cocoon onto Hornsa blocks off any more damage. Sven's running for his life. That's Hornsa down. He's caught on the flank. This might be the last fight. Biofrost is down. RNG looking for more. That's a triple kill. Bjergsen's running out. Uzi's looking for the Quadra. Uzi gets himself. No, that's a shutdown as MLXG picks it up. It's a 5-on-1. Baron buff is available. The inhibitor's being dropped. Once that goes down, Royal never give up. Look to set their sights on the Nexus. Uzi gets himself the fourth. The Nexus is going down. And Team Solo Mid, their hopes, their dreams, they're done. Royal advance to Chicago.
Marta said, give me Uzi, I will take you deep into Worlds. And that is an Uzi game if I have ever seen one.
Royal never give up. Make it out of the group and send TSM back. Now, North America's hopes shift to tomorrow and Cloud9.
And so many questions about this Royal lineup. Xiaohu, horrible tournament so far. Looper being left out to dry. But a gut check, a last-ditch effort, and both players come up huge.
And Xiaohu deserves the credit. I mean, so much of their previous loss to Samsung was him, mistake after mistake. Yet the Aurelion Soul was a giant part of this game. Mid lane pressure, roaming that down into the jungle, into the bottom lane. They absolutely took TSM's bottom lane out of the early game.
RNG's most impressive games at Worlds have been against Team Solo Mid, both of which convincing victories. Now they have to step their game up. They advance to the quarterfinals as the second seed, joining EDG from the LPL as a second seed. This is going to be very difficult for every other group who could potentially draw them and could potentially go up against that level of RNG.
And I'm still not sure what we'll get for the team that does draw RNG, right?
Yep.
You're still a bit worried as to...
Roll the dice.
Thank God you're not the only one, because I've been watching them all year, and this team is just so confusing. When they're at their best, the raw talent, the skill, they can match anyone. And you can see they can play disciplined play when they have to. It's just that they don't at times. If they're at their best, they can take anyone down to the wire.
What does this mean for Team Solo Mid, the NALCS, and Western fans? Europe and North America joined behind TSM.
Hey, we all did.
Unfortunately, they didn't show up in groups.
Yeah, we all did. I mean, TSM this year was such a powerhouse, such a classy team. You could see Bjergsen and Svensson to the very end were trying to battle their way out of that one. You hate to see them go, really.
Definitely. I mean, they put everything into this year, and you could tell the dedication, you know, all the hours that they put in. And it did not work out, though, as RNG are able to take that ticket.
Yeah, they absolutely are. RNG, of course, joining Samsung Galaxy, who Samsung Galaxy looked phenomenal today. Incredible threat going forward as one of those pool one seeds that's going to draw one of the other groups. But just so many question marks. Again, even Samsung Galaxy, week one to week two, if you took name tags off, you wouldn't know it was the same team.
Definitely agree.
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, the improvements this week were... very, very impressive. Also, moving forward, I think they did, you know, convince everyone of Crown's victor, if that needed any
As
clearing
if anybody
up.
Needed more information to work with.
And I think two subs this week have come through. Pawn will most likely start because he looked more impressive. And Core JJ, man, the support player that was a former AD carry, stepping up huge on the world stage. That has got to be one of the best stories coming into the quarterfinals.
Yeah, absolutely converted, especially the fact that he's got some local history here. A lot of the fans and viewers, I'm sure they are going to be aware of him. We're going to have to find out how he performs later on in the tournament. For now, though, we're going to join Shox for an interview with Royal Never Gives Up superstar AD Carry.
Thank you very much, Trevor. Indeed, joined here by Uzi after RNG secures that spot in the quarterfinal. Uzi, what of a relief is it that you guys made it here after you had to play that do or die match? When did you feel the momentum changing in this match?
你们今天打的是起伏的很不定嘛，然后呢，就是今天最后一场也是生死战，你们今天赢了这场之后呢，对你来说是一个多大的放松，然后你什么时候发现说你们可以翻盘赢的呢？首先能赢非常开心，然后也出现了嘛，就因为今天我们的状态说实话不是特别好，在前面两场比赛也是，就是给人的感觉就是已经被淘汰了吧，就。
So we're really happy that we actually made it out of group stage today because our team wasn't really in the best condition to play today. And after our first two games, everyone saw that we're probably already heading home, but we won. We won.
Well, you mentioned it there. It was do or die. Why do you think the group stage was so up and down for your team?
Sorry?
Why do you think the group stage was so up and down for their team?
他刚刚也说，你之前也提到说你们今天这场是生死战吗？ 你觉得你们在小组中为什么打得这么艰辛呢？
就首先可能就我们小组的其他队伍也非常的强，然后我们的状态也没有就是保持到很好吧，就可能中途出现了点失误什么，就会导致我们后面就打得没有往常那么好。
So first of all, I think all the teams in my group, they're really strong teams. And personally for our team, we just weren't at a very consistent performing stage. We weren't really in this right mental state. So we had a lot of, we made a lot of mistakes in game, and that's why we had Yusa.
Yes. Well, RNG now has time to recoup and go into the quarterfinals. Uzi, you have a huge legacy already at Worlds, two-time semi-finalist. How big is the hunger and the pressure on you personally to go far here at Worlds?
你本身你亲自已经来过了，就是世界总决赛两场，反正都打到了总决赛嘛。然后今年对你来说的话，你想要走多远呢？非常能够就是继续进总决赛，因为如果就是进总决赛的话，就是连续三次，也就是非常好的一个就是成绩吧，就非常的开心会。
First off, I want to definitely make it into the finals because then I would be in finals for three times already, and that is a really good score for any player.
Yeah, good. Put it in its place. It is indeed three times finalists. Is that would happen, but you guys are through to the quarterfinals. Congratulations, Uzi, and congratulations, RNG, making it through here out of Group D.
Thank you, Shox. A smile on Uzi's face, and much deserved as they make it through here in this last game to grab that second seed for the group. But gentlemen, I mean, what a game, because surprisingly back and forth based on the way it started. But we have to start in Champ Select, where it really looked like that Aurelion Soul pick threw TSM off.
Yeah, and I personally have been attacking RNG almost all day for some of the pick and ban phases, lack of flexibility and so on. I didn't believe in Xiaohu going into this game, but him getting Aurelion Soul and actually having saved that, this was the first time he's ever played that champion in a professional match. So he's clearly saved it for a very, very important moment. He's using it right now. And if you have a struggling mid laner, give him a pick like Aurelion Soul so he can impact all the lanes, and he did. He played such a good game on this Aurelion Soul.
They had a great game plan. Start on the top side, go to the bottom with the pushing lane. Two pushing lanes as we were talking about before. Control the blue buff and just put all the pressure to the bottom lane. Eventually, TSM just could not handle the pressure. They stuck around a little too long. They refused to give up the bottom lane. And from that point on, RNG just played a pretty clean game to finish the game off.
Yeah, one of the things about the pick and ban phase that was so surprising for me was that Bjergsen was not on a pushing mid laner. And this tournament alone, every time Bjergsen hasn't been able to shove in the lane and roam and assist his team, his team's always gotten pulverized in the early stages. And one of the weird things for me is, even though we saw Ryze into Aurelion Soul earlier on, I think Twisted Fate is one of the missing picks at this Worlds against Aurelion, because not only can he shove to match Aurelion, he can also match his roams pretty strong.
Yeah, and I was going to say, we saw that lack of ability to follow in the very first replay, which only comes 7 minutes of the game. Triple kill for Uzi in the bot lane, but based on the fact that Xiaohu was able to continually push that mid lane.
And this is basically everything they were building towards with the pick and ban phase, going Nami as well, so they had a pushing bot lane. Here he roams down, and it's such a good play. First kill comes in, and then here, Svenskeren doesn't see the cocoon over the wall, so he doesn't flash it, and that means he has to flash after, and he's now too low to really do anything. And even the last auto attack gets double if, so really well played by RNG. And a few key moments there for TSM where each player probably will look back at that one replay and be like, if I just wished the cocoon, if I saw the cocoon, I would have flashed it. That one auto attack as well on double lift. Super, super close, but honestly, super well played.
Yeah, after that moment, you just got to pour one out for TSM. That was, after that moment, just RNG moved across the map, four-man unit everywhere, and there's nothing you could do with that composition like what they had. It's very difficult to find a team fight that you can actually win. And they were able to pull one off, but it's not enough.
But here's the thing, we still had a game, LS, and now I want to kind of identify how it was that TSM was able to keep themselves in it here. And of course, it all started with Bjergsen on that Ryze.
Yeah, I mean, the TSM's team fighting was really immaculate, and I think that RNG really got overzealous with a lot of their team fights, especially in the bottom lane later on. And Haunzer's Jace, even though it wasn't really going off, he did have a pretty big CS advantage, and so that was something that they could have relied on moving into the mid and late game. And honestly, RNG did look a little bit shaky. Had they not RNG'd three Mountain Drakes and got the Baron, I don't know if this game turns out the way that it did. I think TSM could have pulled it out through team fights.
I think it is important to highlight Haunzer like you just did, because while he had like 0-3 or 1-3 score in the end, he got so many towers in the side lanes, and that is still one of the big problems for RNG, is they go for this Poppy pick so often, they just surrender top lane completely, and while, yes, you're winning on the bottom side, if the enemy top lane is 50 CS up, yep, is already taking a tower, that's a lot of extra gold you give to someone who is behind in the bottom lane. So it is a problem for RNG, definitely, but because they played so well around Uzi, and with, of course, Xiaohu roaming, they actually got a big enough advantage from that.
All right, well, now I want to take a look at that base defense put together by TSM. This ace brought to you by Acer here. It's what made the game really close and gave our fans a little bit of hope.
Just keep your eye on Bjergsen. Flashing the Aurelion Soul ultimate combo with the knockup from Svenskeren. He's going to be able to dish out so much damage. And as soon as the carry goes down for RNG, you know that TSM can win this fight because the carries are untouched. And this is the fight that you were really hoping that TSM could do something out of it. They were able to push down mid lane, get two turrets, and really shrink that gold lead.
It is not often you have five members standing right next to each other and you just have all your carries just positioned just around them. Even Haunzer on Jace was down the bottom of your screen, shooting them from one side, Bjergsen from another one, double it from a third angle. Mm-hmm. That was just perfect, you know, just hammer everything in that little corner. It worked for that one fight. Sadly, they were too far behind.
That's the thing. You only get that fight once a game at most, usually, where everything's positioned perfectly. But now I want to push this ahead to the game winner because ultimately RNG was able to hold on to their victory. The Mountain Drake's doing a huge job in helping them secure those Barons so they could make pushes like this.
Yeah, this was the final endgame siege, and they went for a little bit of mistiming there, trying to get Rek'Sai into the back to knock up, but without Rek'Sai going down so early or him getting removed from the fight, you don't really have a way to peel against RNG's team comp, and they just bulldoze through, and at this point, the gold lead's too much. They have too many items over TSM.
Yeah, and also, I think RNG's composition just is better in these late-game team fights. The fact that TSM managed to win some was, you know, credit to them, but also maybe some criticism towards RNG in the late game, wanting a little bit too much in these fights. Because the way this fight was started was kind of the only way to engage for TSM. Normally their composition is built around having like Ryze in one lane, Jayce in another one, and they push up and like flank in. They could never do that because they were so far behind.
And now, Crumbs, we had some discussion here on the desk about who to give player of the game to, and we're like, well, is it Xiaohu for showing up with this pick? Or after seeing the damage graphs there, Uzi, over 42k damage for his team. That's insane. That's who it's going to go to this time around. And I mean, it all was set off by that early triple kill.
And absolutely. While Xiaohu enabled him, he was able to do so much with the resources, and that was the story for Uzi coming into the tournament. The guy gets all the gold and he's able to put it all to perfect use, and with the zone control from the Aurelion Soul, with the Poppy on top of it and Nami to heal him and keep him protected, how are you going to get to him with a comp like that? And he makes it work, and that's what you want to see out of a superstar player.
Yeah, the other thing about it is, even though they were up against three sources of physical damage, he actually went Trinity Force, and so Uzi's build was really accelerated off of that triple kill, and the Trinity Force just makes him that much more slippery to try to handle inside of team fights. And again, you know, pointing out TSM's team composition, they don't have a way to get to the back line.
Well, RNG prevails, and another Chinese team moves on to the quarterfinals. With Group D's games completed, we're sending two more quarterfinalists on to the next round. Group A, Rox Tigers and Albus Nox are going to Chicago. Group B plays their final matches tomorrow. SKT and Cloud9 hold the lead currently. H2K and Edward Gaming are the winners of Group C. Samsung Galaxy and Royal Never Give Up will move on from Group D and head to that knockout stage. Now our final group battles it out for the remaining quarterfinal slots tomorrow. Tune in at 1 p.m. Pacific time as IMA takes on Flash Wolves. Now the four teams in Group B will each play their three remaining games tomorrow. Any ties that remain at the end of the day will be played immediately out in tiebreakers. And right after the last Nexus falls, we'll have our quarterfinal draw live on stage. So clear your calendar because you won't want to miss that. All right, gentlemen, looking forward to tomorrow's matches. Key matchups that you're looking at, teams that you're looking to make a surge and maybe make a statement game.
I think Cloud9 against Flash Wolves is really what it's going to come down to. SKT looks like a clear favorite in this group, even though they did drop that game into the Flash Wolves. They did say they felt like they got lucky by taking that win off the game or out of SKT, and just whoever can really get that head-to-head in that matchup will likely see a similar result to what we just saw today.
Yeah, I completely agree with Crumbs. I think it all comes down to Flash Wolves versus Cloud9. I feel like SK Telecom is the clear favorite to get first out of this group, and it's really just going to come down to that battle in mid lane, Jensen versus Maple.
I look at Flash Wolves SKT, because I think Flash Wolves can actually beat them again. They really understand how to play against them because it's all about Mabel and Kasa. They can camp Faker, who always plays a little bit over-aggressive, take him down and get the advantage. If they get a 2-0 there, that's a lot of wins C9 won't be able to find because they would have to beat SKT themselves, and that obviously didn't work last time. So we might be in a situation where three teams once again are really fighting for the top two spots. I may, sadly, not expecting anything.
All right, and if the last 3 days are proof of anything, it's that we know nothing. So that's going to do it for us here on the Analyst Desk. Stick around for another edition of Worlds Tonight featuring Shox, Jat, and Freak. Now for myself, the casters, and the entire live broadcast crew, thank you for watching, and we'll see you tomorrow. We did it.